Let me just introduce our two other panelists. I already mentioned them. The first is Rob Dijkstra, who is the head of the Dutch College of General Practitioners. Can I invite you to the stage? And a former doctor and epidemiologist, Dick Bell, who wrote, of course, also a book about, and you were nodding some of the times I saw. So please join us on stage. Dick Bell, give them a warm welcome to the stage. Yes. First reaction to the presentation, which is kind of it's not really a summary of the book, which is now today launched here in the Netherlands, but it's the general idea of the book, of course. First response.
Well, I nearly finished reading the book, and it's a book in which I can find myself in, I think, more than 90%, because most of the conclusions I have drawn myself in the past 22 years when I was editor and chief editor of the Dutch Drug Bulletin. How many minutes can I?
this was one sentence. So what you said, I almost with everything I agree.
Regarding drugs, of course, my specialty is drug treatment and drug trials. Yeah. And in the past 22 years, I started with trying to explain the articles that were published in the main scientific journals for doctors and pharmacists. But gradually, it appeared that there were growing major problems with all these studies, especially the fact that trials with negative results weren't published, so you couldn't trust what was published.
Exactly, that's what also Peter Kutcher says, of course, 50% of all research is not published.
Yeah, and then later on it showed that these drug companies are really making a lot of fraud with these trials. So even if you read the trials, you come to the conclusion that it's not good, the study is not good, and then compared with of edits that most trials are not published, and the fraud, it's really a very good advice to use as less drugs as possible.
Okay, and where is the 10% in which you disagree?
I not really disagree, but it's not my specialty to be involved in screening programs.
Okay, so also the notion of that these screening, general population screening programs are actually over-diagnosing patients or creating patients which would never be a patient if the general screening was not there.
Yeah, that's a major problem. I was consulted by a Dutch journalist a few weeks ago about mammography screening, and he sent me four articles, and there was so much to do about it in the Netherlands that they all were throwing mud to each other that it must be done, one said, and the other said, it's very good.
Yeah. It's a big discussion, debate going on at the moment.
Yeah.
Okay. What's your first response?
Well, I think it gives again the clear message that we are not dealing with candy. We're dealing with drugs. We're dealing with real interventions. And,
yeah.
And the message strikes once more that we have to be very careful with that.
Yeah.
As a college, we make our guidelines for GPs, and they're quite popular, but they're also quite restrictive when it comes to prescribing medication, and people try to influence us, and drug companies also try to influence us. But we're very happy to see if we are restrictive again, for example, on the anti-diabetic medication, the new expensive medication, that sometimes you see that there is an adverse effect, that drugs are taken off the market, and that we still didn't have it in our guidelines yet. And that's our moments to be proud of, to be very restrictive. But on the other hand, we know that drugs are prescribed very much and largely. And there's, of course, this debate that goes on together with your patient, the patient that you see not only once, but the second time, the third time, the fourth time, and patients getting stuck into his problems and said, doctor, I would like a solution. And first you talk about, for example, when a patient has a depression, you talk about getting help or talking to the patient yourself, because the doctor himself is a sort of a drug too. And that afterwards you could say, okay, maybe a psychologist could help you, or someone else, or your nurse that we have in the practice on mental care can help you. But you see that some patients, they really get stuck afterwards. And then comes the moment that you start talking or thinking or being asked about starting drugs.
Yeah.
And there's a tension there, because well, of course, also in our guidelines we say, okay, you can use drugs then, and then you start using them. So it's very good to get again the message that taking drugs, you should really think very hard about it.
Yeah, but of course, Mr. Gutsche has a very nice statement, right? You need to be a statistical analyst to actually look at the numbers, because you don't even see it. But on average, mm-hmm. it's a very disturbing figure. Every general practitioner kills one patient a year on average. And of course, yeah. Nobody knows that it happens, but statistics show that number. You just divided the number by the number of general practitioners, and you get the number. So is there enough awareness within your profession that overdiagnosis, overtreatment, over medication is a problem?
Well, I think that people are knowing that they should be careful, and the idea that every GP kills one patient a year
on average
should be related to the fact on how many does he save per year, because that's another yeah. figure. It maybe is
sure.
two or three, you don't know.
Don't worry, no.
And then you can still wonder whether it's worth it or not. But I think it's the message is again, be careful when you prescribe drugs. We have the first example that Peter was mentioning was this painkillers, the NSAIDs, we
yes.
call them, the ibuprofen, Voltaren, etc. We had this big debates in the Netherlands. They are freely available in yeah. every drugstore.
Yes.
And that is this
without prescription.
Yes, you can just buy them and take as much as you can. And I think this is very dangerous, because in for example, in our guidelines, we try to propagate this paracetamol above this NSAIDs, because, well, the difference is clear, mm-hmm. not in effectiveness, but in side effects.
Yeah.
The strange thing is that we can't convince even our government to get them off the market for the free enterprise.
Yeah, but that's not the answer to my question. My question was, does the profession of general practitioners, is it aware of the general phenomenon of overdiagnosing and overtreating patients?
I think I'm not sure, but I think we are aware of the effect that we should be restrictive.
Yeah.
And I think the general practitioner in general is quite restrictive in prescribing. We also get attacked you could say attacked by the public, or by medical specialists who think that we're too much yes. restricted, too long waiting, or keeping the patient at our office, not referring easy enough. And that gives some tension indeed in the medical world.
Good your first interview.
Okay.
Yeah. It's good you also remind us that we save lives sometimes as doctors.
Sometimes, well.
Yes.
Yeah. It happens.
We really do. And all doctors can remember some fantastic examples where we know I saved that child's or that person's life, definitely. So to me, it's not so much a matter of whether GPs save more lives than they take. It's more a matter of that many of those who die get drugs that they should not have gotten. Mm-hmm. So no matter how many lives GPs save, this is still an issue that is important. And as you say, there are, and you attend some of them yourself, that we discussed that We now have international conferences on overdiagnosis, too much medicine and all that. We are really aware that, yeah, to be blunt, we are fed up being taken around in the arena by the drug industry. We want to decide for ourselves.
Yeah. Now, you wanted to respond first, Malcolm.
Yeah, I think there is, in general, in the medical profession, there's a lack of awareness about the side effects of drugs.
Yeah.
We have seen recently a Dutch trial, Strider trial, in which pregnant women with fetuses who were at risk of dying got sildenafil, Viagra. And in the information leaflet, it was written for the women, there's only a mild side effect profile, headache, rhinitis, dizziness. And well, if you read such things, you think, well, I can take it. It might save my baby, but it's not dangerous. But then when you read the literature, you find, for instance, on the website of David Healy, more than 100,000 side effects of these drugs, including deaths, heart rhythm failures, and so forth. And there was also a trial in which sildenafil was given intravenously.
Yeah.
And many of the children died.
Yeah.
So I think when you write such letters for patients, you should be adequate. You should give them good information.
Yeah, and you say we know in general the general practitioners sometimes lack the information about the specific side effects.
Yeah, but not only general practitioners, also specialists.
Specialists.
And I think especially specialists.
Yeah. Now this book is written to, if this is, so we agree that this is going on, and as you say, we are now saying, let's stop this. What is circus mm-hmm. of the pharmaceutical industry? And that is that it's becoming much more awareness about this topic around the profession, of the medical profession. You wrote this book not for the medical profession, right? You wrote the book for patients in the general population. Why do you need the general population? Because your examples were, of course, for us, the general public. How do you Google average questions like, does this sunscreen work for skin cancer?
Yeah.
Or does a breast test work? So why do you need the patients?
Oh, that's easy. One of my colleagues in England, he said something that I have written on my whiteboard at home. It has been there for 15 years at my office. He said, it's easier to educate the public than to re-educate doctors. Because when doctors have become educated, they have a lot of ideas that they believe very firmly in, and it's very difficult to change. It's not only doctors, this is human, that once you have decided on something and become used to it, it's very difficult to change. But it's much easier to work with the general public and try to teach them, you can do something. So
you really want to say something, right? You're already waiting for like 10 minutes. I was just, this was just a preliminary questions, but yes. Who are you?
So my name is Annabel Slingland. I was raised as a doctor, but currently working at Joslin Diabetes Institute in Boston. And so sorry, in America. And what I found was that at MIT, there are heavy discussions going on about all this, and they say exactly the same. They say, once a doctor realizes what he's doing, it's becoming too difficult for him to do his job, so he might quit. Then the American family physician is definitely doing something about it, because in their journal, they have a special edition called Diagnosing Wisely, and it's all about overscreening, overdiagnosis, etc. So I think even in the States, things are getting in the right direction. But what I'm missing in the whole discussion is, we might run the risk of polarizing. So by the time we say we should not do this, and if you have been raising children or looking after children, you know the word no is not in our brain. So that's what you don't do. But what about what should we teach doctors, what they should do more?
We're not there yet.
I think, as we had a discussion before, that especially family physicians or GPs in the UK, that they are the ones who are able to motivate people and to get people into doing the right things, even for themselves.
Mm. Yeah, thank you for that. But that was, of course, that's what we should talk about. But first, we have to see whether we agree on the anat. Yeah, I know. Thank you, but the entire evening. But you're right. This is an important question. So the first is, don't worry, in the United States, some of the people, the family doctors, are also aware of this problem. And the other thing is, what should we do? So if we agree we have to do something, you said, I want to do the general audience because I can teach them, and it's more easy to teach them than to reteach the practitioners. You say, no, we also need the practitioners, and let's talk about what can happen to them, because the journals are writing about it. Also, all kinds of international conferences are about the topic. So what is the to get rid of this issue of over-diagnosing, over-treating, over-medicalization? What needs to change?
Well, I think one of the most important thing is that you start this discussion with your patient.
Yeah.
The traditional way of the patient explaining his problem and the doctor giving a solution is already far left behind. What we have now is that the more you discuss together with the patients what the options are, and we have this new initiative, which is an initiative from the Dutch Patient Federation together with us. It's about the three good questions.
Yeah.
You know about that?
Yeah, I know about it, but please enlighten Peter Gutsche, because it's a
Dutch campaign. Three good questions is a sort of campaign that will start in the coming weeks about the three questions that a patient should have when he goes to the doctor. The first question is, what are my options? And one of the options, of course, is also the option of doing nothing. Second question is, what are the pros and cons of each option? And the third question is, what would you advise in my case? Because every patient is different. We have the tendency to think that you have diabetes patients, asthma, COPD patients, etc. No, we don't have 200 patients. We have 17 million patients or possible patients in the Netherlands, and they are all unique. So I think it's very important to start discussing together with your patient what are the pros and the cons. And if you do that, you educate not only the patient, but you educate also the doctor, because he forces himself to say, well, the pros are not so very big. If you compare, for example, paracetamol with ibuprofen, then if you compare them, you would easily go to paracetamol compared to ibuprofen.
Yeah. I agree. I think there's also a major problem with the regulation of drugs. Drugs get far too easily marketed everywhere in the world. And I think, Peter said it already, drugs get a market authorization when they show a mathematical difference with placebo. Mm-hmm. Statistical significant effect. Well, that's fairly easy for these companies to achieve.
You already
it's
mentioned
it's very easy.
Very easy.
Yeah.
And the regulators are not capable to,
because of the side effects.
Yeah.
Even in a double-blind study.
Yeah.
The even the patients, the participants, but also the researchers.
Yeah.
They
yeah.
kind of know what is yeah. happening with one.
Yeah, and they don't have enough researchers yes. to analyze it. But drugs are for patients, and patients use them. They want to say, I feel better, I am better.
Yeah.
And that's a clinical relevant effect, and that should be the rule for new drugs on the market. And I will tell you that if we use that criterion, there would be no antidepressant on the market. There would be possibly no antipsychotics and anti-dementia drugs, to mention a few.
Okay, so you say we need to have much more awareness in that treatment room where the conversation is between the doctor and the patient. I was wondering, how about the time frame doctors have for that? I mean, it's now 6 minutes for a consult.
No, it's not 6 minutes.
How much
it's,
is it?
Well, it's in my practice, it's 15 minutes. Okay. And in most of the practices between 10 and 15 minutes, but of course that's not even much.
No.
But with patients that really need it, you can take some more time, of course. That's a way of organizing it. But of course, you're pointing at the fact that if you take more time with the patient,
yeah,
I think you would go more to the solutions that are more like talking and explaining and trying to get accustomed. Like psychotherapy is of course therapy through talking and therapy through a process, instead of getting a quick solution. And prescribing drugs is the easiest way. Not prescribing drugs takes more time than prescribing drugs.
Yes.
Yeah, there are some very interesting studies. There was one done quite some years ago that showed that if a GP uses more time the first time the patient comes with a new problem, then you gain more time in the end than the extra investment in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
So by allowing the patient to talk and present the problems and not interrupting already after 15 seconds, which some doctors do, you actually do better in the long run. And then there is another important study that was done by a Danish GP. It's also a number of years ago. She did a qualitative study where patients that had been at a visit to a GP, when they came out, she interviewed them for a very long time about what happened in there, what expectations did they have, what did the doctor do, were they satisfied with that, and all that sort of thing. And what was so remarkable was that she found out that in quite many cases, the patients were not at all interested in getting a drug, which the doctors very often thought they were mm-hmm. interested in, but they were mainly interested in being reassured, this is not dangerous, and it will disappear again, even without treatment, and then fine, then I don't need a drug. That was a very important study.
Yeah. Well, to add to that, we always think that one of the goals should be patient satisfaction. And the patient satisfaction will be the best outcome. But there are quite some nice studies that say that the most satisfied patient do not get the best treatment, which means even that the most satisfied patients get more hospital admissions, and even mortality was higher in the most satisfied patients compared to the lesser satisfied patients. So it also calls for the fact that as a doctor, sometimes you should be, we call it in the Netherlands, a brave doctor.
Yeah.
You should be a brave doctor by saying,
Please say no, we don't do it. No, you can't get it. Yeah, I agree.
We don't do it.
There's another question.
Yeah, yes.
Of course. Yeah.
It's a good one.
There's a movement in the Netherlands called the
I'd like to, I'm a pharmacy licensed GP in the Netherlands. And I try to be aware of the side effects. And yes, I did kill one patient a year at least.
You are aware of that? Yes,
my wife is a forensic doctor, and we try to evaluate every unknown or unseen death. I quit the organization of Rob Dijkstra because of one big thing. The discussion didn't mention that the GPs in the Netherlands are paid for about one third of their practice organization by doing prevention programs. These programs are initialized by the GP organizations, and we write letters to people, we call them to our office, and then we start looking for risk factors, and we start, and even not doctors, but we start to prescribe medication, and it's not a free choice anymore, because if I don't, I don't get the thresholds, the numbers I need for my insurance company, so the big insurance company, they turn on the knobs and they turn down the payment to my practice. So we're kind of hooked already, and this is there is no GP that can run away from it. And I think it's a big worry, because not only doctors are prescribing these medications anymore. And I hoped that my organization would be aware, but they weren't. So this is a concern.
Thank you for your honesty about sharing that you and your wife are researching, and that you acknowledge mm-hmm. that statistic. But the other thing is that in the system of the payment of the practitioner, the huisarts, there is preventive medicine, general screening, writing letters, please come to our practice because you're in a risk category. And that is part of your job. And if you do not do that, you do not adhere to it.
Yeah.
Although we know that screenings, if you do the screenings and you do the comparison, you do not find an effect, a positive effect. He says, I have a problem. I cannot be a generally paid general practitioner here if I do not abide by those rules.
Well, he can be, of course, but we're talking not about preventive exams or health checks or anything. We're talking about diabetic care. We're talking about care for asthma COPD patients. We're talking about patients who have hypertension, which we treat on a more organized way. That's the difference that we're dealing about. And I fully oppose to this criticism, because I think that we organized some things well, which means with our guidelines that we made as a college, of course, we try to give patients the care that they need. And we know that many patients with for example, diabetes also have cardiovascular problems. They need more time than the 10 minutes that we have. And I think we organize it well. Of course, there's one thing that I agree about. It is that in one stage we focused on these indicators. We focused on having to see patients like a sort of a machine that you have to do all kinds of measurements on. And I agree on that point that we have been too dependent on insurance companies. But I think in having patients, for example, like diabetes patients as a population that need a special care, I fully agree on.
You wanted to respond?
Yeah, I think you actually responded to it, because what I would tell you is that if you are being asked of screening people, you should respond back. What is the evidence for that? Are there randomized trials that show that it does more good than harm? Because if they are not, you should really protest against public health, whatever, that initiates things that are not very good, because this happens in all countries, not your organization, but it could be a National Board of Health that initiates something that isn't very good, and then you should protest, of course.
But you say it's not a screening.
It's not writing letters to let people come for health checks. That's complete nonsense.
No,
it's really treating patients with diseases.
Who are already diagnosed with a disease, and you say because of the system of only 15 minutes talks to those patients, it's more efficient, and it benefits the patient to have more time for a focused conversation.
Yes.
That is what you're saying.
Yeah.
Okay. You want to respond back?
These patients, for example, we didn't separate the groups of people that we had to invite to our practices. We didn't make any difference in thresholds for people of 50 or 70 or 80 years. Later on, it came, and you know as well as I do that all the programs that we did in the care of elderly people, that it's very doubtful if they work at all, because there's a constant discussion about it. The scientific journal of GPs in the Netherlands, just a few weeks ago, I wrote an article back about screening of mama cancer in women. There was a very good article in British Medical Journal. But nevertheless, one of the authors in this journal, paid by the screening industry, wrote a simple article with the conclusion, please doctors, invite your patients for the screening program. Instead of advising to read the independent article. So there is a lot of discussion, and I think that the voice of criticism is not very good heard.
Do you want to respond again?
Yeah, well, the last thing I want to say about it is, of course, we should be aware of protocolized care. We shouldn't see care as a sort of protocol that you have to follow. And especially, I think, in the elderly population, we should be even more critical on the evidence that is gathered by a younger population to expand it to the older population, because, it's not always applicable. And I think one of the things that GPs are strong in is personalized approach, but they are sometimes hindered by protocols. And I think the protocols we should be very much aware of.
Everybody needs an earning every month, you know, to pay your bills. Because of an earning model thinking, isn't it so that the emphasis is all about treatment and not about curing anymore? And is the influence of business schools optimizing earning models not too much?
A fundamental question, yeah.
Yeah, I think that the emphasis is on treating with drugs especially. And I think that's quite a failure of the medical study, that doctors aren't good trained in what is actually means that a drug, that they give a drug and what you achieve with it. Writing a recipe at the end of a consult is easily done, but it's very easy. But most drugs don't work, what I explained, and they don't help patients. It's only a temporary solution. And in the long run, people get healed because of the natural cause, which is positive, the placebo effect, and the empathic relation of the general practitioner. So I think there's far too much emphasis on treatment. I agree.
Of course, there is. Of course, the market entered the.
Oh yeah.
But entered the treatment room.
There, if you want to make money, then you have to prescribe a lot and refer a lot of patients, because then your waiting room can be filled with other patients. But I think that GPs are not on that track. What we did for about 6-7 years is to give our information to the patient by, for example, our website thuisarts.nl. You might have heard of it. It's our guidelines. It translated into patient language. And what you see is that patients use it more and more. It's the most popular medical website in the country at this moment. And what I even saw in my own practice is that our practice assistants refer patients to this website when they want to make an appointment. And the patient, they call back and say, I saw the website. We can cancel the appointment because I know what to do. And I think that is a nice model. And I presented this once in an international conference, and my Belgian and Swiss colleagues, they said, we don't want that because it's not good for our business. So it's in the mind of some people, indeed. I think in the Netherlands, it's a bit less that.
Yeah, I think I've also been studying the Dutch system in the 70s when we had an airlift to Houston. And then those patients were suffering from coronary artery disease. And the surgeons in those days were really rock stars. Well, this all contributed to the belief systems of patients who then thought that a CABG, so the bypass operation, was the only cure and was the magic bullet. But if you look at the numbers and the statistics, even in those days, the numbers were already falling because of prevention. Nobody noticed it. There were debates going on for 7 years. So I think with this whole belief system and conceptualization of, okay, no drugs, if we provide a concept with an alternative, what they can do, and we put more emphasis on that, maybe that might work better. Like,
okay, you say, just say no, because that was also the question of you, of course. If everybody who raised a child knows that no has no relation, doesn't anything happen in the brain with the word no? You say, let's give something else.
Well, the thing is that a lot of scientific information, what we are all referring to, so everyone says study X, Y, Z, those studies do not reach the patients unless they start reading your book. But
Google.
and fire that stimulator to get into Google. Then still you might want to see a doctor who gives you tender love and care, confidence, and goes over these decisions with you, because some patients make decisions on their own that are fatal as well. So I think it's not only a question about yes or no this, but also about that we should realize that some books are just too far-fetched and too far away, and polarize and therefore do not reach an audience that they could have reached. For example, Trinidad, who the depression epidemics or something like that. Finally, what did it really change?
Okay, and so and that means that there is a role for general practitioners to act because the general population will not be reached. Proactive because people are not reached with knowledge in these books.
Okay.
Because you not only translate them.
Yeah.
But make them more active themselves. A lot of patients are like frogs in a pond.
Which is a myth. Try it. They will go out. No, it's not true. It's a myth. Please.
Yeah.
They will go out.
Let's not get into a long discussion about saying no. I just disagree with you. If things are very clear, like don't get a PSA test, then for heaven's sake, tell people, don't do it, say no. If they need that information, and it's not... I mean, when people have said no to me during my medical education, I didn't take that negatively. If a chief physician told me, oh, that's a bad idea, we shouldn't do this because of this and that, and I said, okay, fine, I know that now, and not something about consider with your patient whether a PSA test is right for you. Of course, it's not right for anybody.
Mr. Goetscher, so I have two things I still want to discuss. So if people are to read your book or are following this discussion and they just follow your guidelines, say no to most drugs only when they cure, and be sure, check it out, what the effects of studies are, and be aware that a lot of drugs on the market are not working or only temporary working.
Yeah.
Be aware that screening generally is not, in a lot of cases, are not working.
Yeah.
Is there a risk in that message? There's now a big debate in the Netherlands going on, for instance, about the general vaccination on ovarian cancer, is it called? Baarmoederhalskanker. And there is a big debate going on, and people are saying, we read studies on the internet, it's not working. And then all these medical professionals have to come on the television to say, please go to the general vaccination program for young girls to prevent this form of cancer.
Oh, no, let me comment on that.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not suggesting in my book, like what you almost indicated, I'm not telling people not to take drugs. I'm telling them to be very, very careful because drugs kill so many people.
Yeah.
So they need to do something themselves to find out what do these drugs do. When I was a biologist before I became a doctor, I actually worked in the drug industry and I did trials with one of these arthritis drugs. And I couldn't understand why people ate so many drugs. I think they can't all be that effective. And when I read the package insert for naproxen and saw in how many different ways that arthritis drug could kill me, I decided on the spot I would never take a drug like that for the rest of my life. So I read the package insert. Now, when you're talking about HPV vaccines, that's a very complicated issue. We, just to make it very brief, some vaccines are absolutely fantastic. So we should be very careful not to tell people something about vaccines that are not correct. Our authorities have told people something about the HPV vaccines that are not correct. And therefore, some people are skeptical towards vaccines in general, also measles and all the good ones. That's very bad. Now, what they told people, which is not correct, is that these young women who faint and get pain, nervous originated pain, you know, chronic regional pain syndrome and these things. And the authorities have said, oh, no, it's probably psychological. We don't believe in
it. It's not related to the
vaccine. No, we don't believe in it because the European Medicines Agency has cleared this and they don't exist, these serious harms. They certainly do. We have had access to clinical study reports from the European Medicines Agency. we have criticized the agency enormously because they have not compared these vaccines with a placebo group. They have compared these HPV vaccines with another vaccine, hepatitis vaccine. Now, if this vaccine gives the same harms, you will not detect that the HPV vaccine also gives these harms because you didn't have a placebo group. So we have criticized these studies immensely. And now that we have access to clinical study reports, we have actually succeeded to show that, yes, there is a signal. There are more serious neurological harms with the HPV vaccines than with the control group vaccines. There actually is. And we have submitted this for publication, and it will be published before too long. I'm just telling you that we succeeded to find a signal, although the drug industry and the drug regulators had done anything they could in order for us not to find anything. This, I mean, it's quite few people who are affected, but that doesn't matter. When the public feels that it has been deceived, which I think it will when they see our results, then it's bad for vaccines in general.
Yes.
So that's a boomerang. We should not lie to people in order to make all of them show up for HPV vaccinations. Yeah. And we should tell people there are scientific uncertainties. Yes, we are aware there is no placebo group. So we don't really know whether these vaccines are harmful. You see the point? We don't know.
No.
Yeah, I agree.
I don't know is a very good answer, I think.
Yeah.
We don't know.
Yes.
Yeah, and I agree with this. I think the governments in Europe, especially in the Netherlands, have made some big mistakes by not explaining the pros and cons of certain therapies.
Yeah, because that's now one of the three wise questions.
Yeah.
Everybody now is campaigning about, but it's not discussed. I'll continue. You agree. What did you want to respond? Because, of course, the risk is that if you give general information, this is risky. You're not saying do not take drugs. You are saying be really critical. And go talk to your practitioners and your doctors. Yeah. What are the effects? And read about it and confront him with the knowledge you have.
And I can just give you one quick example. I have a section on vaccines in my new book. And I write about the HPV vaccines. I write about other vaccines. And then for fun, I thought, what about Japanese encephalitis? I travel in the tropics sometimes. I've never taken it. Now I thought I will find out. So I made some calculations in my book, and I came to the conclusion that the WHO's blanket recommendation that if you go to these areas where they have Japanese encephalitis in Thailand and other areas, then it's better to get the vaccine. I calculated it's better not to get the vaccine.
Okay.
And I actually explain why in my book, because some people are killed by the vaccine.
Yeah, I think it's sometimes difficult to change behavior or change policies. If you look at, for example, the influenza vaccinations, of course there are some doubts about the effectiveness of that too. But it's very difficult to go back and say, okay, let's not vaccinate half of the population and see the other half as a control, or see them as a control group compared to the ones who have the intervention. And I think there's some hesitation on the government level, which makes them that we continue doing the same thing.
Hi, Judith Schuren, I'm a statistician. I have a question for Mr. Dijkstra about the three questions. I heard this on a podcast, so I didn't look it up myself. The podcast is named The Recommended Dose, which is really cool. It's a podcast about overdiagnosis. And I heard it was originally four questions. So what are my options? The pros and cons, for what does it for me, but also what is the uncertainty about the pros and cons? So why?
How sure are you?
Yeah. So why did four questions turn into three?
Well, what happened to the fourth question?
So the fourth question evaporated. I don't know what happened, but I think also on this pros and cons, you should be very critical. And it's, of course, there's the patient questions. This is not the doctor's question, because we had this workshop on the Wonka World Conference last week where I presented the five questions. So it's not even four, but five questions for the doctor who has to deal with patients and be critical on what he would advise, because also for a doctor, a patient is unique, which means that he has to deal with patients who have very high health literacy and very low health literacy, or very comorbidity, other diseases or preferences that you should deal with. So I think it's more complicated than just simple three questions. You have to remain critical on this individual patient. I think that's the core of the whole message.
Yes. So if everybody in the Netherlands would read your book, Peter Kutcher, and they would all follow your advice, and on Monday there will be a storm at the reception desk of all these general practitioners in the Netherlands. Everybody wants to meet. Because they want to review their medication. What, in general, that's just a ridiculous image. But in general, what would happen? Because you call it an emancipation movement, right?
Yeah.
You make it part of a notion of freedom. Mm-hmm. What would change the society?
What would change it?
Yeah, so if everybody would follow this advice and would actually take their own medication serious and start talking to the practitioner or the medical profession with critical questions about why am I getting this medicine? What is the relationship between the other medicine I have? Why can't I find any effect in Cochrane about this treatment? What would happen in general between the relationship between patient and physician?
Well, the big problem is that systems are very hard to change. So even if you do your best, you can obtain very little at best. But we still try. And this way of thinking could also be a good way of re-educating doctors, because when the patients come with their information, then sometimes they're wrong, and then the doctor can explain, that's not totally right because so-and-so, go home and read about this. Yeah. And in other cases, the doctor can then admit, oh my God, I never thought about that. Thank you for your information. And you're not a worse doctor, actually, you're a better doctor if you admit that you're not perfect. It creates respect in your patients. So don't behave like Mr. Know-All. That's a novel by Somerset Maugham we read many years ago. Just behave as a human being, and then we can obtain some changes.
Yeah, I think the benefit will be that we may have more critical patients that come to ask, how about me? So let's discuss it, and it helps when in the next years we'll have our medical files opened to the patients so that they can look at their data already themselves and come with more critical attitude. It may help doctors to become more critical too. So patients may educate doctors in that.
Yeah, and that is of course part of a creating a balance of equality in the relationship, and that of course is what you call it an emancipation movement. I mean, you become.
I never use that.
No, you call it part of the freedom.
Word really? No. What did I say?
Freedom. I have it down that it's part of a movement to free. I was looking at the quote.
You should know.
Well, no, it was translated into Dutch. That might be a translation error.
Right.
I don't recognize
the notion.
The notion, okay. No. But of course, my idea is to install some confidence in people so that they can help reduce the number of deaths on drugs. Because our drug regulators, the drug industry, and we can't count on them. We need to do something ourselves.
Yeah,
and I think the growing awareness in patients and doctors should urge the politicians to change this system, because that's the basic problem. Yeah. The system is completely rotten. Huh?
Yeah, it doesn't work really. If it worked, we wouldn't have so many deaths. It's very easy.
No. Yeah. You say so because political decisions and regulations are not changed enough. We need, and that's of course what you said so beautifully 15 years ago, a colleague of you said, educating the public is easier than re-educated. People already are educated in something. Yeah. If they believe something is true, that it's really difficult to convince them otherwise of something different. Yeah.
May I tell you a very good story? Because this is difficult, and although we do our best, but let me tell you a very good story. I have studied psychiatry for more than 10 years now. And these specialists are very, very difficult because they believe in these psychiatric drugs. And the more I have studied them, the more I have come to the conclusion we should hardly use any of them. I mean, usage should be less than 1% of what it is now, only in acute situations, and then stop. They don't work in the long run. They are harmful. So we have a whole specialty that if they really look at themselves in the mirror at night and say, maybe Peter Gertrude is right, I mean, then they need to learn psychotherapy, which they maybe never learned, but it's not too late, and skip the drugs. So there is a way out, but it's so hard for them that they stick to their wrong ideas. I tell you, in Norway, Sweden, Finland, Australia, New Zealand, America, everywhere, you have professors of psychiatry who will tell you that depression pills protect children against suicide. They do the opposite. And the authorities warn against using these pills in children because they drive them into suicide. And yet, professors of psychiatry will tell you the opposite based on lousy observational research, not randomized trials, but here we use less drugs and then there are more suicides. But if they go to another country, they find the opposite. Here we use more drugs and there are more suicides, so they do cause suicides. You can get any result you want based on such research. But here comes a good point. Now, in Norway, Finland, and Denmark, usage of depression pills in Finland, Sweden, and Norway, it still goes up in children. In Denmark, it went down in 2010. So the last 6-7 years, the usage in children in Denmark has dropped by 41%. Mm-hmm. It goes up in the other Nordic countries. What happened in Denmark? Two things. In 2010, the National Board of Health wrote to the doctors, we would prefer that you general practitioners do not use depression pills in children. It should be child psychiatrists who do this. And you know, GPs sometimes don't know the guidance. Sometimes they don't care about it. They just do it anyhow. And sometimes they follow the guidance. But then another thing happened. There was a radio interview with Lundbeck's director. They sell depression pills, a lot of them. He said on radio, yes, these pills protect against suicide. Then the interviewer said, then why do the Danish drug agency warn against them? Oh, yes, but that will change in the future, he said. I was flabbergasted. I was so angry that I wrote an article about Lundbeck on a Danish science site. And then ever since, I've been very vocal in Denmark. I've been on television, radio, newspaper articles, and so on.
And it has an effect.
I have warned and warned and warned for the last almost 10 years. Don't use these damn pills in children. So there are two factors, the National Board of Health and me.
Yes.
So the only thing I regret is I don't know what percentage I contributed.
No.
Because if my contribution was just 5%, I can forget about it. But if it was more, it starts getting interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Because then we can change things.
Yes.
By hammering it out again and again and again.
Repeating, repeating, repeating.
Yes.
The message.
Yes.
Unfortunately, we cannot do that analysis for you as well. I mean, I don't know the effect.
No, but I heard yesterday. I heard yesterday a general practitioner. Yes, it was a GP in Groningen, who said, "Oh, but also in Holland, the authorities have warned against these pills."
For children.
And usage has gone down in children, he said. Mm-hmm. So I said, show me the data, because I haven't been here in Holland very much, so it's not due to me. So I would like to know how much.
I'm gonna finish this evening. It's 10:04 already. I'm gonna give you two people who wanted to say something, the final word, and you can respond to that. Yes.
Like the bankers, medical profession is highly based on trust. And what happened to the scientific method, the academic ethics?
Okay, that's just a cri de cœur. Oui, oui. you wanted to say something? You had your hand. Oh, but you already cancelled it. You didn't want to say anything anymore. Okay, no, you don't have to come up with anything. I thought you wanted to say it. Yeah. Thank you for that. Do you want to respond to the critiqueur from the audience?
It's not really possible to respond to that question without having another evening.
Yes, about the ethics.
Yes.
It's an entire evening.
It's a long, okay, long one.
Thank you so much for this. Give this panel, hopefully, a big applause for their contribution. Hoe overleef ik wegwijzer in een overvloed aan medische informatie? Het boek ligt daar straks te koop. U kunt het kopen. Ik zie geen bedrag. Kan iemand dat zeggen? 20 euro? 24,90. Ja, heel goed. Dan weet je het. You can do this with a pinpas, probably, ATM. And I have to remind you, or please, the programmers at the Bali always think, what kind of audience is there in the room? And can we make some noise about another program next week? There will be an evening about failures, medical failures, and about, changing the omerta, or that people do not share their failures in medical profession. So you're, invited to join that evening. For those who are still... who are in the medical profession, I hope a revolt will start and everybody will start calling you on Monday. But otherwise, I hope you have had some inspiration for another talk with your patients. And for those who are studying medicine, I wish you a very joyful professional life the coming 40 years. Statistical information, sometimes you need to forget it a bit, because otherwise it's quite frightening to enter a field where you will kill, on average, every year, one patient. Thank you for being here. And for all the patients in the room, start doing research on your own health. Be responsible for the information, finding the information of the things you are actually taking and putting into your body. Thank you for your attention. Audience.